American songwriters call them bridges, we tend to call them middle eights. Either way, they're best defined as that bit of a song that isn't the verse or the chorus. Take Smokey Robinson's Tracks of My Tears. This is the verse.
People say I'm the life of the party, 'cause I tell a joke or two.
After the verse comes the chorus.
So take a good look at my face. You'll see my smile looks out of place.
And then what's this? Well, it's the bridge, the middle eight. Now, confusingly, they're not always in the middle of a song, and they're not always eight bars in length. But I'll let experienced songwriters Justin Curry and Boo Hewardeen help me to understand that later on. First, though, what are middle eights for, and what do they do? I went to talk to Helen Caddick, who teaches songwriting at Goldsmiths College in London, and the music journalist David Hepworth.
The best pop music is not just about catchiness. The best pop music has catchiness which contains within it the promise of further catchiness. And very often the second layer of catchiness is in the middle eight.
Whatever you taught me, I didn't believe it. Father, you fought me, 'cause I didn't care, and I still don't.
And so it's a little bit like eating a box of chocolates where you think you've got to the end and behold, there's a further layer below. How the heart leaps at that prospect.
For me, the verse is telling a story. It's got to have a really good, interesting thread like Eleanor Rigby.
Eleanor Rigby picks up the rice in the church where a wedding has been. Lives in a dream.
So the verse for me tells the story. The chorus would state the message of the song, and it should be something catchy, should have a really good hook in it.
All the lonely people, where do they all come from? All the
lonely... The middle eight is almost like a cry of loneliness. It absolutely wrenches your heartstrings. That middle eight just adds an emotional depth to it that perhaps the verse and the chorus don't quite deliver, but the middle eight can really give something else. I mean, in Common People, Pulp, when he's singing, it's quite kind of low-key, relaxed, chilled out, the initial verse. And then when he goes into that middle eight, he's saying, you're never really going to be a common person because you're always going to have your dad to bail you out. So how can you ever say you're really a commoner like us? You're not.
That strikes me sometimes about middle eights lyrically is that I sometimes come to feel that actually that's the bit that the song's about. Classic case is Do You Know the Way to San Jose, written by Burt Bacharach and Hal David. It's a song about, you know, somebody going home, and you're not entirely clear why they're going home until you get to the middle eight. All the stars that never were are parking cars and pumping gas. You know, so you realise you're seeing the horizon of Los Angeles and the Hollywood sign, and you're seeing the Boulevard of Broken Dreams and everybody leaving town with their, you know, possessions in a spotted hanky on the end of a stick. Sometimes I think it's sort of a different person singing the song in the middle eight. Every Breath You Take by The Police, which is, I would say, arguably the greatest record ever made. The verses are very kind of vengeful. And the middle eight's in love.
Again, like the Eleanor Rigby, it's that real kind of cry of loneliness, but it's so ambiguous because it's almost a bit like the Scorsese films, where he'll use a really beautiful piece of classical music juxtaposed against the boxing scene, the Cavalleria Rusticana. You know that with every breath you take, inside there is brewing something not nice, because it's about stalking.
If you take Born to Run by Bruce Springsteen, the middle eight is again a kind of aerial view.
Beyond the palace, semi-fire drones scream down the boulevard. Girls comb their hairs in rearview mirrors, and the boys try to look so hard. The amusement park ride and roll and start. Kids are home on the beach and the mirrors. I want to die with you, Wendy, on the street tonight, and an everlasting kiss.
It's this heightening effect that allows him to then go back into the final verse, like, it's downhill all the way from here. You know?
So it's a great big jumping board. It's a big platform.
It's a big platform, you know, which you can certainly hear on the record, you know, with that kind of gathering arrangement and that kind of yell that everybody, and in concert, everybody joins in that. That piece of theatre which the record is providing for them.
I see parallels with what Emily Sandow did recently in her song Heaven, where she drops this really driving drum beat and she drops down to this almost prayer-like, slow-moving gospel harmony middle eight, which is exactly what Elvis does in Suspicious Minds. And so, of course, when the final chorus kicks in, it's got dramatic, massive impetus. It just adds massive colour. It's like going from the palest blue back to the hottest red, going from a cold outside to a warm room. You know, you feel it in the music.
You say that you will wait. I try but always break, cause the day always lasts too long.
So where did the idea of a bridge or a middle eight come from? Jazz pianist Neil Cowley told me you can trace its origins back to the 18th century and one of the greatest classical composers.
Believe it or not, I think there is a thread between Mozart and these kind of pop middle eights. And I found this old book of mine. I found this old, one of my first music books, a Mozart collection of sonatas. And my piano teacher has scribbled in these three elements. The exposition, which is the sort of the stating of the theme, in this case, which is a sonata in C major, you've got this. And so on and so on, which is a very simple C major theme. And then after about two pages, he's written development, which I think is a sort of the Baroque version of the middle eight. And it really sort of highlights how kind of what a technical exercise the middle eight is. I think this is why musicians possibly get more chin scratchy about the middle eight, because there the science comes in. Because the whole idea is, you know, we don't want to get bored with the theme. So break up the theme, stop playing the theme, but play something similar, which eventually gets you back to the theme. And it's the recapitulation in this form is the revisiting of the theme. So the development in this case. So where we had the theme, he's taken it up a fifth, and the fifth is important, and he's given it a minor note. So right, okay, so we've got a new mood. I'm thinking now, well, how's he going to get back to that original theme? So sure enough, he's going to go round, and then eight bars later he goes, and then about 16 bars later he goes, now this is a cycle of fifth, so this is a jazz thing. It's a million jazz tunes have a cycle of fifth. The whole, you know, the jazz library is made up of. Oh, so it's like they all go around this cycle of fifths. Mozart's doing it 300 years before. G, D, A, and then how's he going to get back to the C? He's going to, by fair means or foul, he's going to go to the G, to, and then he goes, so he goes, and then he goes, recapitulation. We're back to the theme. Oh, we're here again. So he's done his own middle eight, and I think this sets the tone for many middle eights. It sets the tone for we're going to change it, we're going to change things up a bit, we're going to vary it. How the hell are we going to get back to where we started?
Neil Cowley. Mozart's sonata form was echoed in popular music 200 years later. Songwriter Bu Huerdin has been described as the middle eight doctor. If you need a bridge building, he's your man. And he told me that the expression itself originated in Tin Pan Alley.
Technically, the word came from when people wrote standards in the 30s and 40s and so forth. The shape of the song used to go eight bars of one thing, which you call the A, did that again, that's an A, then it'd go to a B section, where you go off on a little journey, and then you come back to the A section. And that is where the term middle eight comes from, because it's an eight-bar part in the middle of a 32-bar section. And I wanted to play you one, if that's all right.
Please do.
Yes. I was thinking this morning about that, and I remembered the song Whispering Grass, which has been damaged somewhat by Donna Stell and Windsor Davis's version, but it's actually a very beautiful song, and it's a really good illustration of the middle eight. Sung by a man with a cold. Why do you whisper green grass? Why tell the trees what ain't so? Whispering grass, the trees don't need to know. Why tell them all your secrets? Who kissed there long ago? Whispering grass, the trees don't need to know. Here comes your middle eight. So don't you tell it to the breeze, 'cause she will tell the birds and bees, and everyone will know. Yes, you told them once before, now it's no secret anymore. Why tell them all the old things? They're buried under the snow. Whispering grass, don't tell the trees, 'cause the trees don't need to know.
Bu Huerdin. We'll be back with him in a minute to hear a new middle eight he's composed for a well-known Bee Gees song, which doesn't have one. But one of the UK's other experts at musical bridge building is Justin Curry, who made his name as the singer and main songwriter in Delamitri. I asked him to talk me through the process of writing one of the biggest hits, Always the Last to Know.
Last to Know is quite illogical because it's an infidelity song, so, or at least it's about, you know, the singer's woman has, you know, has seen somebody else and he's found out about it sort of last, so obviously the chorus is always the last to know. So the verses are quite obvious, you know. And so you're in love with someone else, someone who burns within your soul, and it looks like I am the last to know. So there's a verse with that payoff line, the last to know, and then the chorus, which will just develop on last to know. The last to know how you're feeling, the last to know where you are, the last to know if you're happy now, or if he's treating you like I treated you, or if he's cruel, and I'll be the last to know. So there's like the verse and chorus, and then, yeah, you just reach a point after two verse and chorus where you're a bit bored, and then it's got to go somewhere else, so, and I'll be the last to know. And then here's the middle eight. Creation's gone crazy, TV's gone mad, now you're the only sane thing that I have. So I guess the point in that is, you know, it's different chords, it steps out of the rhythm and the, and also it's being sort of directly honest as well, in the way that the rest of the song's being maybe a bit more distant or something.
But it also gives you that step for the repeat choruses at the end.
Exactly.
It gives you that platform to go, and here we go.
Or for the big guitar solo, where in the video the guy's in the top of the mountain with a, you know, with a wind machine.